Hello, I'm Sabine O'Hara, Dean of the University of the District of Columbia's College of Agriculture, Urban Sustainability, and Environmental Sciences, and host of the television series Causes. The cause driving this television series is you, the residents of the District of Columbia. Our mission is to improve the quality of life and economic opportunity for the people and communities of the District of Columbia, and by extension, the quality of life for people across the nation and the world. We pursue our mission through our academic programs in nutrition, dietetics, nursing, health education, architecture, and environmental science, and through our research-based community education programs that serve thousands of residents in every ward of the district, through our land grant centers in nutrition, diet, and health, sustainable development, urban agriculture, architectural research, and youth development. Our topic today is making a difference. And that's, of course, what Causes is all about. When we say that the mission and work of Causes is to improve the quality of life and economic opportunity for our students and for residents in the District of Columbia, we are driven by the desire to make a difference in people's lives and to make the world a better place. But it's not only the college that wants to do this. We are finding that many of our students are driven by the same desire to make a difference in people's lives and to make the world a better place. Two of them are with me today. They are Juna Kharel and Christopher Lane. Juna is a candidate for a Bachelor's of Science degree in architecture, and Christopher is a freshly minted graduate who received a Bachelor's of Science degree in public health education. Congratulations, Chris.
Thank you.
And Juna, welcome to both of you to Causes TV. So let me start with you, Juna. I attended the jury when seniors or rising seniors in architecture who completed their last design course were presenting their senior projects. And you were one of the selected, the students selected to present your senior project. And what really struck me, and it was a very interesting assignment that you had, namely to build a residence hall for students.
Yes.
And what really struck me was how much you spoke about the people who would be living in that residence hall and how much the motivation to make their lives enjoyable and comfortable, but also aesthetically pleasing, how much of that seemed to have motivated your design. So tell me a little bit about that, because you sort of, you know, I was expecting a building and a discussion of a building, and you really discussed people.
Yes, we were doing a student housing on the side of UDC itself, which was a tennis court. And what, as a student of architecture, we just don't think about building. It's like interior and exterior space, and with that we go with the flow of social science, psychology, human behavior, history, materials, laws, codes of DC. This is all what we need to include while we are designing, and human behavior is very important aspect of any design, any project for architecture students. So when I designed my project, I walked myself through the building, around the building, so that what I experience is what people experience, what my clients experience. So that was one of the things that was very important to me. And the color was very important, because picking a color is, you can't make a building whole one, it will look very, just one color. So I tried to make different colors and play around with that. And usually when I go to see a resident hall, most of them are very rectangular shape, because there is a set measurement for a residential building, which is 60 feet, 55, 60, 65, this is how you go. So this is what you need to work on. So it's very hard when you do apartment style building. You can see around DC, it's all a rectangular, straight, vertical going building. So what I tried to do is, I tried to go up and down, back and forth on the building, and some curves, and so that people won't feel like you're living in a housing. You feel like you're in some, fancy place, rather just, you know, being a student and studying all the time. You can go see around the building, have different places where you can just sit besides sitting just in your room. So that was very important. That's a human behavior. Mm-hmm. Like as a human, I would like, when I am in my room, I like to see outside even while I'm studying, mm-hmm. you know, because it connects me to the outside world. It connects me to the nature, mm-hmm. and that gives freshness. Mm-hmm. You know, your mind works very well when you're looking outside around the people, with people, you know. So that was a very important factor, which I included in my design project, student mm-hmm. housing.
So really the design helps connect people, both
exactly.
to each other and
to the nature, is very important mm-hmm. to the nature. Mm-hmm. Yes, for a mind to work, a healthy mind to work in a healthy place. It
yes.
has to be a healthy place, yes.
So speaking about healthy mind and healthy place, couldn't have been a better lead to,
yeah.
to what you've been studying, Chris. So tell us a little bit about public health education.
Yeah, so I have been studying public health, and I recently got my degree, so that's really exciting here. And I've really enjoyed the experience of getting that here. And also, I believe Washington, D.C. is the mecca for public health. Mm-hmm. You know, there are so many different people from all over the country, from all over the world, that reside here or work here or travel here. And I just think that public health is essential in making sure that we look at the whole person mm-hmm. and make sure that the people are educated enough to know what those dots are, as we talked about, mm-hmm. Connecting those dots. How do I live better? What do I need to eat? How does that affect my well-being? How does that affect my mental health? How does that affect my spiritual health? How does that affect my physical health? So marrying all of those different factors to make sure that we're taking care of the whole person. And that's what public health is. It looks at many things. It's looking at the statistics of a population with epidemiology. What does the disease burden, how does that affect mm-hmm. different populations? How does that affect different demographics? Who are more susceptible to food deserts? What does that look like? How does one who lives in an impoverished area or community, how do they live and how do they make it when they don't actually have the fresh fruits and foods yes. that they need to be healthy? So you have the other restaurants that may not have that kind of food that's healthy for them, but that's all that they have available. So how do we intervene in that and make sure that our residents have healthy, safe places to live, healthy food to eat, and access to great health care. Mm-hmm.
And you know, you mentioned the district as sort of a wonderful melting pool, almost
yes.
want to say, right, of different
yes.
cultures and different people. But I almost want to say, unfortunately, we also are sort of an exemplar of a very bifurcated community, right? Where on the one hand, we have people with very good access
right.
to resources, and then we have places where that is not the case.
You're absolutely right. And I don't think it's just really endemic to DC.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's endemic to places all over this country
mm-hmm.
and all over the world. You know, I grew up in Mississippi and have lived there most of my life, except for the past 10 years. And poverty to me looks very similar to what poverty
mm-hmm.
looks like in DC.
Mm-hmm.
And you have a lot of people that would want to feel that these people do not want anything better for themselves, or they want to live this way, or that they wanted to be dependent upon certain governmental, I guess, incentives. But that's not always the case. I grew up with a mom who's a single parent. She raised four children, and we didn't have the best of everything. But we all knew we wanted something better, because that's what she instilled in us.
Mm-hmm.
While she couldn't do it for us as much as she would have liked to, because of some serious illnesses that she was being challenged with, she knew that it was necessary for us to have that same access. So with that, seeing after working here in the district and then working in Mississippi, it looks the same. And when you give people an opportunity to respond, and you give them the resources to respond with, they almost always do it.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's the link that sometimes is missing when we look at people who we see as less fortunate. We sort of kind of dismiss them. And we put the bad places in their neighborhoods because they'll accept it. But that's not okay. We have to make sure that these people are getting the same kind of treatment and resources and food and healthcare that everyone else is getting. So if you look at wards 7 and 8 here, and you look at wards 1 and 2, we need to make sure that the access to good, healthy food, good health care are in both the dichotomy of both of those wards.
And of course, often, you know, it's having that information first,
yes.
right? Having that knowledge first, so you
yes.
know what you're asking for,
right?
Right.
Right.
Because sometimes that's, you know, it's kind of difficult to say, well, what am I advocating for?
Right.
If we're not accustomed to connecting the dots,
absolutely.
To see what leads to what.
Yeah. Absolutely. And that's true, because many of the parents are the families who live in those impoverished areas who are not getting the best. If they knew what they needed to know to get there, they would respond. And I think a lot of times, because we feel like they don't show up, it's not because they don't know or they don't want to. Well, it's not because they don't want to. Mm-hmm. Sometimes they just don't know. Mm-hmm. And so I think it's incumbent upon us who have that knowledge and information to make sure that it gets out there, to make sure that they get access to the same resources so that they can have live healthy and better lives as well.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. What's in terms of learning and exploring these influences of what influences healthy spaces, people's health, but also the built environment, not just the natural environment. What's sort of next for you, Juna? You're still going to be here in the fall. You're going to be a rising senior. But what are you curious about?
What I am curious about is after graduating, like how I, you know, like building, when you design something, like any building, whatever, it is about designing, it reflects your personality. So I want to give my best. You know, whenever I do a building, you can see what I am, like what my nature is, looks like, you know. So I'm more like, I like to explore things. I don't like to stick with the same old fashioned, you know, design, you know, which, sometimes you see that even with the students, it's easy to do the easy stuff, you know. So
you've seen it before, right?
Yeah, you have seen it before. It's easy to draw. It takes less time, you know. But I always wanted to do something different, you know, because when you go to your field, there are so many things you can't do. You know, there are more boundaries, there are more limitations. Policies, laws, restrictions. So as a student, I always tried to do what I feel like. I didn't care how long it took. I was like, at a point, I'm like, I'm not gonna finish it, you know? But I did what I wanted to do. So I'm hoping that I can do it when I go to my field later. I'm hoping I can do the same what I'm doing right now. So yeah, I wanna see how it, you know, takes me to field of architecture, designing something different from rest of the people, making your own identity. This is what I'm curious about right now. So we'll see how it goes.
Is there anything particular that you are, you know, any type of building? Like you designed a residence hall.
Right, I did a resident hall before we did School of Nursing. So I am really into monumental stuff, you know, monumental kind of buildings. Museum, I love to do museums, libraries, you know, so like big scale buildings. Like, I'm really into commercial buildings, but I think I will do with all my passion whatever kind of building it is. If I get a project, doesn't matter, it's commercial or residential, but yeah.
That's great.
I really like to do monumental buildings.
That's great. That's awesome. Chris, you have exciting things in front of you, because
yes.
I know you have been accepted to Dartmouth.
Yes.
Into the public health program there for your master's degree.
Exactly.
So congratulations.
Thank
That's
you.
No small Thank feat you. To get into that place, right? So what is your curiosity? What's sort of next for you?
So, of course, I definitely wanted to see what it is like to be a part of such a great institution, you know, other than UDC, to expand my learning around in public health. And to look at what I'm really curious about is how we can look at the current health systems and to see where the gaps are as it relates to access for people who may not have the resources to get there. How do we get them there? How do we change the mindset? How do we change the conversation and dialogue about how we deal with people that we consider the less fortunate or the less than? I don't think that we as a country have done really well at, especially within the last, I guess, few years, how we haven't done really well with getting those folks in the door. Mm-hmm. While I am really, really was excited about the Affordable Care Act, I think it could have gone a step further, you know, to make sure that that everyone has access, true access to healthcare. So I'm really curious about those things around the healthcare system. How can we improve upon that? How far can we go? Mm-hmm. And how does it look for different demographics? And what can we do to, as policy goes, to eliminate those kinds of gaps mm-hmm. that are there that may not get people at the door?
Mm-hmm. And of course, the Affordable Care Act is what people often refer to as
Obamacare. Right. Yeah.
When you say there are elements in that that you'd really like to push further.
Right.
Tell me a little bit more.
So I was really hoping that there would be a public option so that everyone, regardless, would have access to healthcare.
Like a single payer system?
Yes, a single payer mm-hmm. system. And I know that there were many that felt like it was moving towards a socialist kind of economy, but you know, we're really not a capitalist economy. We're more of a mixed economy. Mm-hmm. So, and I think having that, those tenets of some of those things in our government is good, you know? And so I think that seeing, hopefully at some point, seeing if that can even go there, because I don't know if it's gonna, you know, I think that there was a lot of scary things that were said and I guess expected, but we're coming up on October 1, which is where we're going to see a lot of that play out. So being able to go back to that, to drawing board, and see what gaps were missing, so to expand mm-hmm. that, you know, mm-hmm. to see if that can possibly happen.
Mm-hmm. So really, you're raising the question of what is the role of the market, and
right.
and where are there simply gaps
right.
where the market doesn't sort of automatically take care of things, and then what do we do?
Right? Right, because I think, you know, we're seeing some of it play out now, but I don't think we're going to see a lot of it until it's been fully enforced, and I think we'll see that a lot of that after October mm-hmm. of this year. So wondering also too, how can we make sure that people of color are getting access to care in a way that's keeping that's I guess eliminating some of the high rates of obesity, mm-hmm. of stroke, of hypertension, of heart disease, breast cancer for African American women. So looking at where we're dropping the ball with that, mm-hmm. why is this demographic disproportionately affected by such ills, mm-hmm. and how can public health be, I guess, an advocate for mm-hmm. those persons who sometimes don't have the advocacy or the voice for themselves. Mm-hmm.
I guess what I hear you raise here is the question of prevention, right?
Right.
How can
right.
we avoid
right.
getting so deep into the healthcare
right.
system, and looking at how do people stay healthy
right.
rather
Absolutely.
Than needing to rely on the healthcare system so much.
Yes,
yeah.
right.
And of course, that's also this question of social health and,
exactly.
and environmental health.
Exactly.
How do people...
Exactly.
How does that contribute, right?
Right?
We're not sort of bubbles in space here.
Yeah, and also making sure that people know what public health is.
Mm-hmm.
So we did a project in one of my classes where we created this program. Mm-hmm. And we were supposed to create a program about public health. And what I chose to create mine was to informing young people at an early age about public health. So we have a lot of the charter schools that are specific to certain disciplines. Maybe we should have a charter school specific to public health, because I think DC is a ripe place for that, because of all of the, you know, we have the world, you know, different organizations here, the World Bank, you know, so many, like I said before, cultures and people that are here. So making sure that young folks understand the importance of public health and what their role is in that, because I think everything we do has some public health aspect to it in our daily lives, whether we're getting up eating breakfast, whether we're on the highway, you know, so safety. So looking at all of those aspects of public health and making sure that people understand what that is mm-hmm. and how we as public health scientists can get that word out.
Mm-hmm. And of course, you know, it also reminds me very much of this topic that's more prominent now than it used to be, namely healthy buildings.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And of course,
yes.
the shortcut is building materials,
right.
but
right.
I guess there's a lot more to it than
yes.
that.
Yes, there are a lot of sustainable buildings, green buildings,
yes.
that it's going around. green, like solar, we did one solar project on the first semester of fourth year. It was very new experience because I didn't know before, you know, how you do a building without using actually your air conditioner or heating conditioner, air conditioning thing. So what we do is, in solar buildings, is we try to bring up solar energy using photovoltaic cells, like solar panels. So that is very interesting because this is where the built environment comes in, like the solar pattern, how the sun works, and how sun itself can do a lot more to a building. Like when you do even a residential single house, people are so used to just turn on the AC and, you know, get, but you can have an operable windows, you can just open it up, you know, get the wind. You can do cross ventilation, like having two windows on two different walls, and where the air passes and it circulates the air, it brings the air in and takes the bad air out. So you can do that. You can do, like, the south sun is considered a very good sun, you know, like, mm-hmm. you can get the most of the solar from the south side of the building. So you can put all your windows and all your habitable spaces, the, like, living room, bedrooms, on the south of the side of the building. So that from there you can get sun. You don't need to use AC. And even on what we do is east, sunrise from the east, so east sun is very light. But when it goes to the west side, it's very harsh. It's very strong radiation that comes. So usually on the west side, you can put a lot of plants. Mm-hmm. So this is where, again, the built environment comes, all plants and stuff. We study plants too.
Yeah.
So on the west side, you put a lot of plants. And on the north side, you get there is no sun on the north side. So what you get, all you get is air. So you try to put all the trees on the north side, mm-hmm. the tall trees, so that mm-hmm. the air doesn't come straight to your room, cools it up. It just takes you up from the roof. Mm-hmm. So those things, it's a healthy style of living without using a mechanical process, chemicals, all this mm-hmm. thing. So this is very important in architecture mm-hmm. too. And I learned so many things that I didn't know from this small project. It was a modular building, like a classroom, a restroom, a little space, that's all. But you get to know so much things about solar energy buildings and how you can make green roofs, you know, there is a space on your roof that nobody can access to. Well, you can just do a green roof and make it look nice and get all the humid and moisture that it captures the green roofs and makes your space better mm-hmm. living. So those are very interesting things you learn, a built environment, and, you know, this definitely changes a human behavior mm-hmm. when you get sunlight rather than the turning on the lights, mm-hmm. you know. Mm-hmm. That's how I do it when I'm in my apartment too. Like when I'm inside, it's daytime, I never turn on my light. So open all the windows and doors, mm-hmm. that's it. It mm-hmm. just relaxes you know, mm-hmm. natural light. Mm-hmm. So those are things, very important things, mm-hmm. very little things that people know, but they didn't know how to apply it to your building.
Yeah.
So yeah, this is very important.
And of course, that also impact people's health.
Right. When I remember when I was a kid, like, we didn't have AC and all this fancy stuff back when I was back in Nepal. So I remember my parents used to open a window when it's morning time, and when it's little on around 4 or 5, they put the curtain on so that you don't get the harsh. So I used to think curtain is just to close the window, but now I realize it's not to get all the harm radiations inside mm-hmm. the room. So everything, when you go back like 50 years, 60 years before, people, what they do, probably they didn't know why they do, but there is always a scientific reason. Mm-hmm. And it's about health issues, leaving, you know, spaces. So that all makes sense now when I'm studying architecture, and I'm mm-hmm. glad I did architecture. Mm-hmm.
So both of you have also been immersed a bit in the sciences,
yes.
mm-hmm. in both of your fields,
yes.
in looking at all the different connections of how people's health and wellness is impacted.
Yes.
Very, very complex issues,
absolutely.
Right?
Yes, very.
And never a dearth for things to learn and
right.
for new things to learn, right?
Right.
So how we connect our fields as well as going more in depth in any particular field.
Right.
So you both sound very excited and very happy with your chosen field.
Yes, absolutely.
Yes. At a time, I was like so tired, you know, doing all this project, a week of sleepless nights and not going out, no personal life, no social life, just doing project. And by the end of the project, when you get appreciated for what you do, it's really worth it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, you'll be like, yes, this is what I wanted all my life. This is what I want to do.
Absolutely. It's very important. It's really exciting because, you know, it's like when you meet this person that you know that you fit with and you meet with. And that's exactly what I felt when I came into the field of public health. I knew exactly this is what I wanted to do because you meet so many great people and so many persons who need to know the importance of public health, you know. So yes, it's really exciting, you know, and doing it while working full time was also a challenge.
Yeah.
But, you know, it feels really good to have completed that chapter.
Well, my guests today were Juna Kharel, a candidate for a bachelor's degree in architecture, and Christopher Lane, a recent graduate from the UDC Public Health Education Program. Again, congratulations,
thank
Chris,
you.
Thank you.
See you in the fall, Juna.
Sure.
And thank you, our audience, for joining me on Causes, a television series from the College of Agriculture, Urban Sustainability, and Environmental Sciences of the University of the District of Columbia. We are dedicated to improving the quality of life and economic opportunity for people and communities in the District of Columbia. If you would like more information, please visit us at www.udc.edu-causes. I am Sabine O'Hara. See you next time on Causes.